Hi folks, welcome back again this week. Well, we're up to Revelation chapter 10 and the angel and the little scroll. But we did speak last week. I mentioned Gog and Magog and I put a little challenge, like who do you think Gog and Magog is? We're not to that chapter yet where it speaks directly about Gog and Magog. But I think it'll be an encouragement to be thinking about it. Keeping in mind that the whole book of Revelation is all reliant and reflective of the seven letters to the seven churches. Everything after the seven letters to the seven churches is expounding on what has already been said. The trumpets are in the seven letters to the seven churches. The opening of the seals is in the seven letters to the seven churches. The seven bowls of God's wrath is in the seven letters to the seven churches. So what we're studying is in the remainder of the book of Revelation is simply an expounding of those seven. The seventh angel, the sixth angel, the fifth angel, and so on, is all reflective on the seventh, the sixth, the fifth spirit. Now remember the sevenfold spirit of God. Now we're way back to chapter 1 of Revelation, where it speaks of the sevenfold or seven spirits that surround the throne. Those seven spirits, the spirit of grace, number one at Ephesus, the spirit of truth, number two, the second angel at Smyrna. Number three, this knowledge of grace and truth leading to the spirit of the fear of the Lord at
Pergamum.
That's the third angel. So when you go farther into the book of Revelation and you read about the third angel sounded his trumpet, remember, it's speaking about the fear of the Lord, the spirit of the fear of the Lord. It's showing you blessings and curses. It's showing you the wrath of God. It's showing you what's going to happen. And what does happen in every instance in life when you go against the fear of the Lord. When we stop fearing God, these are the ramifications. These are the consequences. Whatever the third angel speaks of, that's the consequence of not fearing God. So, in spite of the book of Revelation appearing to be some futuristic prophecy, it's more than that. It is active and in operation in every generation since the birth of mankind. It's always been. You've heard me say in the past, the book of Revelation, or I should say Armageddon, it takes place in every generation. It takes place in the minds and hearts of people and has taken place all back through the centuries. But it is coming to a climax where it engulfs the entire world, the whole planet. So it could have been taking place in a small group of people 1,000 years ago. But none of the rest of the world was affected by it, just this small group. But Armageddon is a climax of what's going on in life, in your everyday life right now. So understanding the book of Revelation is, I'd consider, somewhat important. So we're at Revelation chapter 10. We're going to read from verse 1 and forward and see what it's got to say now. Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head. His face was like the sun. His legs were like fiery pillars. Wow. We're gonna do a little bit of searching. We've only done one verse. We're going to do a little searching. What have you got for us, honey?
Sure, we don't have to go any further?
No.
Okay. So it's Daniel chapter 7, starting at verse 13. In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached.
Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud. What did you just read?
One like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven.
Okay, go ahead from there.
He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All peoples, nations, and men of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed.
So he's being led into the presence of the Ancient of Days. There's a lot of implication there as to what that means. We say that Jesus is God, and we say that God is Father Truth. His spirit, his heart, unconditional love, and his son, Jesus the Christ, the form, the one and only ever begotten bodily form, in which God has always stood visible all throughout the ages. Jesus, I've said in the past, Jesus is, it's in the book of Numbers, I believe, 12:8. I'm going to go there. Just give me a sec. F-O-R-M is all I'm going to punch in. And then I'm going to go to the book of Numbers. 12:8. With him, him being Moses, the Lord is speaking here. With Moses, I speak face to face, clearly and not in riddles. He sees the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak? Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? So Moses saw the form of God. What did Moses see?
Jesus.
He saw Jesus. Later on, Abraham. He saw and spoke with Melchizedek. But Melchizedek is identified in Scripture as having no beginning and no end, not having a mother or a father. And it says that Melchizedek was the high priest of God. What does that mean? Well, if you were to read, I don't like the analogy because I'm not God, but if you were to read Bestiary, the book I wrote, and make available, by the way, to those who want it, who would you say is Ed Bridge's high priest? You have never seen Ed Bridge. You've just purchased a book written by some clown up in Northern Ontario, Canada. That's all you've ever seen. You don't know who Ed Bridge is. You didn't recognize him or nothing. But if you wanted to say, who is the high priest of Ed Bridge? I would say, I am. I am. You read this book, you're hearing what I have to say. Melchizedek is identified as the high priest of God. But later on in the New Testament, Jesus is identified as the high priest of God. In the Old Testament, Melchizedek is the eternal high priest of God. In the New Testament, Jesus is the eternal high priest of God. Has there been a change in priesthood? No.
And don't forget, when it's talking about God in this context, it's talking about the Lord God Almighty, which is Father Truth.
Father Truth.
That's how it you can say, well...
He's the Word.
You can say God, and you can say Jesus here, and it's not saying that they're not the same, but there's also a difference, too, and you need to recognize what that difference is. It's not that there's two different entities. It's that God is Father Truth, and Jesus is truth and love in form.
This is my word. This is my word in flesh. I am the high priest of my word. Melchizedek was the high priest of God. But who was he? Well, you've heard me tell you often, he's Jesus. He's still Jesus. So, where was the point of that now?
I don't know.
I got to go back. So we have to go back to Revelation 10. And what we were speaking of. And I saw another angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head, and his face was like the sun, and his legs were fiery, like fiery pillars. And you read from Daniel?
Daniel 7:13.
And what? Read that again for us. We'll keep going over and over till we get it all straight.
In my vision at night, I looked, and there before me was one like a son of man coming with the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days and was led into his presence. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. All peoples, nations, and men of every language worshipped him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that will not pass away, and his kingdom is one that will never be destroyed.
Okay. So this brings us back to the point I was making. Jesus is God himself in his one and only ever begotten bodily form. So we've got a connection with the clouds. Remember the clouds in Scripture? Clouds are the witnesses. They're us. Remember last week's, the 200 million? They're us. Remember the 144,000 2 weeks ago? They are from each of the tribes. Go back to Genesis chapter 49. Look at each of the tribes. Look at Revelation, where we've already discussed in the past, it speaks of given a new name. That new name is the Israel of God. But it only known to the one who receives it. Look at the book of Genesis, chapter 49. Read all through the descriptions of the 12 tribes, which tribe defeats you. What's your character? Are you a Dan, or are you a Judah, or are you a Naphtali, or are you a Benjamin? We may find Benjamin, for example, the wolf. We may find him a bit, what would be the word to describe?
Repulsive.
But Benjamin's one of the tribes of Israel. And Benjamin, as well as all the other tribes, are going to have something to say when that 12,000 from each tribe stands up. So the 200 million is us, but the 144,000, the 12,000 from each of the 12 tribes, 12 times 12 is 144,000, they're the ones that are teaching us. And they're teaching us from the perspective, from the character of each of the tribes. Mm-hmm. So will Naphtali be there teaching us? Yes, Naphtali's the gentle doe. Who doesn't want to learn from someone that's gentle? But will Dan be there teaching us? He's the serpent by the wayside. That boy, he's the critic. He's watching for every little slip of the tongue. You say something that, maybe you made a little bit of a mistake in how you spoke some message. Dan's there to bring it to light. Well, it's not exactly right what the Bible says. Oh, he's a critic, I'll tell you. Does he have a place? Well, according to Moses in the book of Deuteronomy, when he describes the 12 tribes, Genesis 49 is Jacob's description of his sons, the 12 tribes. But in Deuteronomy, it's Moses describing the 12 tribes, and he's positive towards every one of them. Every one of them have their place. So the 144,000 are going to be teaching the 200 million. They are from where the 200 million are going to realize what the scripture's telling us. And they are sent by God to fight who? As I said, we mentioned Gog and Magog last week. Who's Gog and Magog? Who's the enemy of truth?
Falsehood.
Pardon?
Falsehood.
Falsehood. The devil. The dragon. The Antichrist. The beast. Out of the land and out of the sea. The false prophets. Where do they all get their power? From the father of lies. Who's the father of lies? It's Gog. It's falsehood, the devil. Remember, if truth manifests visibly, remember we're the body of Christ? Remember Jesus? We are his body now? In living flesh, truth and love in us, who do we fight? Falsehood. What's the spirit of falsehood? Hatred of truth. He despises truth. He wants to be God. But if God can manifest visibly in bodily form, don't think for a minute the devil can't manifest visibly in bodily form. Who's Magog? If Gog is the devil and the devil is falsehood, who's Magog? Well, it's his hordes. It's all the people. All the antichrists. All those who were against worshiping the one true God. How does it say in John? These are the ones the Father seeks. Those who worship in spirit, what's the spirit of truth? Love. And in truth. It's a big battle, isn't it? But look, it's a battle that we all fight every day. Isn't that strange? What Paul says, I die every day. I die every day. Well, how can that be if you die every day? How are you standing there teaching us if you're dead? Well, he's talking about putting to death what he wants, what the man, the worldly man, the earthly man would want. Not reading the law from the idea of an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, meaning you hurt me, I'll hurt you. No, not looking at it from that perspective. Looking at it from the perspective of, I'll put what I think I want to death, so that what God wants, who's God? Truth and love, might get what he wants. So I might write to retaliate the man inside me. Retaliation is kind of a knee-jerk reaction, isn't it? It's just there. You have to fight against it. Somebody offends you and, you deserve a punch in the mouth, buddy. But no, I'm not going to punch you in the mouth. Instead of punching you in the mouth, I'm going to share with you God and his Christ in the hopes that I can drive the devil out of you. because the way that you're talking or the way you're behaving is not of God. It's not a reflection of truth and love. So I try not to be a hypocrite in reflecting the devil instead of reflecting the God I claim to serve. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. What else did you have that was very pertinent to Revelation chapter 10, verse 1?
It's also in Revelation, back in chapter 1, verse 12. I turned around to see the voice that was speaking to me, and when I turned, I saw 7 golden lampstands, and among the lampstands was someone like a son of man, dressed in a robe reaching down to his feet with a golden sash around his chest. His head and hair were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were like blazing fire. His feet were like bronze glowing in a furnace, and his voice was like the sound of rushing waters. In his right hand he held 7 stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp double-edged sword. His face was like the sun shining in all its brilliance. When I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. Then he placed his right hand on me and said, "Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever, and I hold the keys of death and Hades."
Who's that?
It's Jesus.
It's Jesus. I was dead. They crucified God, yeah? And behold, I'm alive forever and ever. He's risen from the dead. As Paul said, he cannot be put to death a second time. He's eternal. Yeah, it's Jesus. It's Jesus.
I got one more.
Okay.
Speaking of the, what does it say about the rainbow in yours?
With a rainbow above his head.
Yeah, robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head. Back Genesis chapter 9, verse 16. Whenever the rainbow appears in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and all living creatures of every kind on the earth. So, the clouds are the cloud of witnesses.
Cloud of witnesses. They're us, yes. The clouds are us.
Yeah, and so the rainbow, I think, in especially in the context of here in Revelation, is to show that, like, yes, at the end, it's judgment, and at the end, it's truth with no more grace, Abaddon, but Jesus is still truth and love,
yeah,
manifest in form.
Yeah. And you think of a rainbow, and multicolored, isn't it? It's multicolored. And you think of the Israel of God, you think of the 12 patriarchs. Each of their characters bears a different color, doesn't it? They're multicolored. It's all kinds. We can't allow ourselves to become judgmental of the people who are around us simply by their behavior. Because, like I said, Benjamin's a wolf, Dan's a serpent, Naphtali's a gentle fawn, Issachar is a lazy jackass. Judah's a lion. Multicolored, isn't it? Multicolored. But who is this then in verse 1 of chapter 10? Then I saw another mighty angel coming down from heaven. He was robed in a cloud with a rainbow above his head, and his face was like the sun. His legs were like fiery pillars. It's Jesus. He was holding a little scroll. You've got one. Which lay open in his hand. It's not a closed book. If your Bible's collecting dust, there's something wrong with the idea of Jesus being in you. He planted his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land. And he gave a loud shout like the roar of a lion. Remember, Jesus comes back, the Lion of Judah? When he shouted, the voices of the 7 thunders spoke. Wait a minute, where does thunder come from?
Lightning.
Lightning. The heavens, yeah, lightning. The positive and the negatives colliding up in the sky, in the thunder clouds, and the lightning taking place, and then as light travels much faster than sound, we see the lightning, but then we hear the thunder. Well, at this verse, when the lion roars, we've already seen the lightning. We're at chapter 10 of Revelation. Look back and watch the other videos. What have we already seen? We've seen the lightning. Now we hear the thunder. What is it all talking about? And the seven thunders spoke. And when the seven thunders spoke, I was about to write, but I heard a voice from heaven say, seal up what the seven thunders have said, and do not write it down. Why not? Because it's unnecessary. Those who are supposed to, they've seen the lightning, they shouldn't be surprised at hearing the thunder. And they should know what the thunder is talking about without anyone writing it down for them. Then the angel I had seen standing on the sea and on the land, that's Jesus again, raised his right hand to heaven, and he swore by him who lives forever and ever, who created the heavens and all that is in them, the earth and all that is in it, the sea and all that is in it, and said, there will be no more delay. But in the days when the seventh angel is about to sound his trumpet, the mystery of God will be accomplished, just as he announced to his servants the prophets. Have I not revealed to you the mystery of God? Are you catching it yet? Mm-hmm. You even understand Gog and Magog now, which is way over in chapter
20.
Is it chapter 20?
Yeah.
We're only in chapter 10.
Although even just this little bit here, anyone that wants to do a little side project, you should go read, which one was it? 38? Is that a 3? Yeah. Ezekiel 38 and 39, the full chapters. I think that's what we read earlier, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If you want to see correlation.
If you really want an eye opener, go on my channel and in the search bar, type in Armageddon, just the word Armageddon. A video will come up. Watch it. Find out what Armageddon means. Har Megiddo. That's what Armageddon is referring to. What does Harar mean? What does Megiddo mean? You'll find all that information in that video. It's been up for years. Those who have still already seen the lightning shouldn't be surprised at what the thunders say. Then the voice that I had heard from heaven spoke to me once more. Go, take the scroll that lies open in the hand of the angel who is standing on the sea and on the land. So I went to the angel and asked him to give me the little scroll. And he said to me, take it and eat. It will turn your stomach sour, but in your mouth it will be as sweet as honey. Is he right? Boy, is he ever right. Boy, is he ever right. When I took those verses to heart, and I picked up my Bible and I started reading it, asking the Lord to show me what it's all talking about, it was as sweet as honey in my mouth. But the more I understood, the more it turned my stomach sour. Oh, crap. We have not.
Well, it's like when you're little and you go to church every Sunday because it's what you do, And they're just all like, oh, praise the Lord, and everything's going to be great, and we're all going to prosper and have lots of money, and everything's going to be wonderful, and can't wait for the day of the Lord, and we're all going to go home and live on, you know, eating Philadelphia cream cheese on the clouds. And then the more you understand it from reading it, and the more you realize what a bunch of bullshit that was, and that everyone should be terrified of what's coming.
Yeah.
You know?
We have a tendency of portraying the gospel in a fashion that makes it all...
Well, we whitewash it.
Yeah.
It's no different.
Actually, the Old Testament speaks of the prophets whitewashing the gospel.
Well, it's the same. I mean, I think it's a good similarity. You know, we see all of these beautiful paintings of the crucifixion,
mm-hmm.
and Jesus has this beautiful, unblemished, unmarked porcelain skin while he's up there on the cross, and he's so serene, you know, and you think, well, the Bible says that he was marred beyond human recognition. Yeah. What do you got to do to somebody's face to make it so that you can't even tell that they're human anymore? So while the paintings are beautiful, and I appreciate that people wanted to depict the Lord in that beautiful manner, it has done harm to Christians and secular people, because nobody understands what, like, understanding it, how violent and how much hatred was involved in that, is kind of the point. And the point now has been lost on the majority of people because they associate that image of the unblemished Christ instead of what the Bible says, which is no, it wasn't some serene, this is lovely. It was horrible.
Yeah. Are you saving anything there?
No, I don't. Though I
have. Can I have your Bible? I'm going to look up the word illegitimate. In the book of Hosea 5:7, they are unfaithful to the Lord. They give birth to illegitimate children. This is speaking of the Israel of God. It's talking about us. Jesus in John chapter 8, verse 37, I know you are Abraham's descendants. Now he's talking to the Pharisees, the teachers of the law. Yet you are ready to kill me because you have no room for my word. I am telling you what I have seen in the Father's presence, and you do what you have heard from your father. Abraham is our father, they answered. Well, if you were Abraham's children, said Jesus, then you would do the things Abraham did. As it is, you are determined to kill me. A man who has told you the truth, that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. You are doing the things your own father does. We are not illegitimate children, they protested. Jesus is challenging what they're saying about that they're the children of God. He's challenging it. And they say, we are not illegitimate children. The only father we have is God himself. And Jesus said to them, if God were your father, you would love me, for I came from God, and now I am here. I have not come on my own, but he sent me. Why is my language not clear to you? That's a question. Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father, the devil. Falsehood. And you want to carry out your father's desire. Destroy truth. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth. For there is no truth in him. There's no truth in falsehood. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. So we're sticking to the topic of what are illegitimate children? I'm in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 7. If you are not disciplined, and everyone undergoes discipline, then you are illegitimate children and not true sons of God. Moreover, we have all had human fathers who disciplined us, and we respect them for it. How much more should we submit to the Father of our spirits and live? What did Paul say? I die every day. To what the devil would have him do, so that he do what God wants him to do. What did Jesus say? Love your enemies. Ask you to go a mile, go two. Ask for your coat, give them your sweater as well. In doing so, it says you heap burning coals of destruction on their heads. Because you're a reflection, or your behavior presents a reflection of the God you serve. Truth in an attitude of love. Jesus is his name. So when people say we've got to take control and get even, run away. I took the little scroll from the angel's hand and I ate it. It tasted as sweet as honey in my mouth, but when I had eaten it, my stomach turned sour. Then I was told, you must prophesy again about many peoples, nations, languages, and kings. Do you remember what it says about Elijah coming again at the end? Yeah. Yes, John the Baptist was Elijah in his day, but Elijah's still going to come again. What will he be preaching? He'll be showing you the sour and the sweet. That's the end of chapter 10. Have we got time?
We're almost at 45. I think that's a better...
38.
Well, I think 40 minutes is better than an hour, but it's up to you.
Well, let's go ahead into chapter 11 a little bit anyways. I was given a reed like a measuring rod, and was told, go measure the temple of God and the altar and count the worshipers there, but exclude the outer court. Do not measure it, because it has been given to the Gentiles. They will trample the holy city for 42 months. What's this holy city? Most everybody thinks it's Jerusalem over in the state of Israel. No, it's not. The new Jerusalem it's us. We're the bride. This is the bride being trampled. It's not a building of brick and stone. There's only three temples in the Bible. The first two were brick and stone, and they've been destroyed. The third one is eternal. It's the new Jerusalem. It's a Jerusalem of the mind and heart, dedicated to serve truth and love. Jesus is his name. And the Gentiles, they're going to trample on us for 42 months. And I will give power to my two witnesses, and they will prophesy for 1260 days clothed in sackcloth, mourning and grief, sackcloth and ash. Mourning and grief. It's got nothing to do with putting on dirty old clothes or anything. No, it's a matter of the mind and heart. Who are these two witnesses? Who do you think they are? I want to leave you with this question for this week. Who do you think the two witnesses are? If you watch my videos, you already know who they are. But how many people have watched and retained what I've told you in the past, because I've told you all of this before? Who are these two witnesses? I'll leave you with that for this week. So we finished at verse 4. These are the two olive trees and the two lampstands that stand before the Lord of the earth. Who are these two witnesses? Oh, well, it would be easy to say, well, these are the two olive trees. Okay, who are the two olive trees? Oh, well, the two lampstands. Okay, so who are the two lampstands?
Elsewhere, it's also two pillars.
Is it?
I don't know if it's here, but I mean elsewhere in the Bible.
If anyone tries to harm them, fire comes from their mouths and destroys their enemies. Ooh, fire comes from their mouths. What's the power of God again?
Truth revealed. Well, the gospel.
The gospel, isn't it, eh? Who are these two witnesses? I've got to stop myself because I really do want to keep going, but I'm going to leave you with that. Who are these two witnesses? And it's important you get this right. You can look up and you can search the two olive trees. That'll help you to know who the two witnesses are. You can search the lampstands. That'll help you to understand who the two witnesses are. But I'll tell you, they are powerful. They are very powerful. Lord willing, we see you again next week. We love you all. Bye for now.